As for me, I will see your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake in your likeness. My name's Arthur. Thank you for joining me as we meditate again in Psalm 17. We've looked at this psalm before, working through the first half of it, and seeing that David is calling out to the Lord to vindicate him from the Lord's presence, for the Lord to look down on the situation and, according to his marvellous loving kindness, to do something to rescue David from the predicament that he's in. Now, it's not a predicament that he has generated for himself, except insofar as he has walked in the paths of the Lord. And as he's walked in the paths of the Lord, he's got into trouble because there are others who are walking in the paths of the destroyer, and they oppose him. They are his enemies, his deadly enemies, who surround him. They are lurking, looking for an opportunity. They're in secret places. He finds them where he doesn't expect them. And they are seeking to oppress and indeed to kill him. David is not seeking to fight them himself. He is looking to his God to act on his behalf. Because part of the way of the Lord is the statement, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay." And so David is saying, well, you're the judge of the earth. I do not have the authority, but you have the authority to act. Now, David was a judge. He was the king of Israel, and he had authority over his people to judge between one and another. But when the situation involved himself, he has to make a judgment between himself and another, then he is not qualified to do that. He must call upon his God. And so it is in our circumstances that there are times when we might have responsibility to care for others, but when it becomes an attack upon ourselves, our situation is biased by our perception and our understanding. To what extent is the claim against us justified, and do we need to repent, or not justified at all, and we must stand? So then we must call upon the Lord to vindicate us and to show the right path. David is confident in his God. You hear those who call upon you. Well, let's read the psalm, but we'll focus on the second half of it in our meditation. Psalm 17, a prayer of David. Hear a just cause, O Lord, attend to my cry. Give ear to my prayer, which is not from deceitful lips. Let my vindication come from your presence. Let your eyes look on the things that are upright. You have tested my heart. You have visited me in the night. You have tried me and have found nothing. I have purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Concerning the works of men, by the word of your lips, I have kept away from the paths of the destroyer. Uphold my steps in your paths, that my footsteps may not slip. I have called upon you, for you will hear me, O God. Incline your ear to me and hear my speech. Show your marvellous loving kindness by your right hand, O you who save those who trust in you, from those who rise up against them. Keep them as the apple of your eye. Hide me under the shadow of your wings, from the wicked who oppress me, from my deadly enemies who surround me. They have closed up their fat hearts, with their mouths they speak proudly. They have now surrounded us in our steps. They have set their eyes crouching down to the earth, as a lion is eager to tear his prey, and like a young lion lurking in secret places. Arise, O Lord, confront him. Cast him down. Deliver my life from the wicked with your sword. With your hand from men, O Lord, from men of the world who have their portion in this life, and whose belly you will fill with your hidden treasure. They are satisfied with children, and leave the rest of their possession for their babes. As for me, I will see your face in righteousness. I will be satisfied when I awake in your likeness. And may the Lord bless these words again to us. So the steps are that David claims his right to approach God, that he is speaking plainly and honestly, that he's not trying to deceive God or to use God. His cause is just, He's making a claim that the Lord can investigate and see that is true. And the Lord should act because he should see the injustice of the situation and act to vindicate David, who is in the right. But the Lord is the judge, and the Lord is the one who must act. How does he justify his confidence? Well, he says, "You have tested me, you have tried me, and you have found no fault in me. I have avoided the paths of the destroyer, and I've walked in your paths. So I'm relying upon you that your path is right. You must make your path secure." So he is confident in his God because he is on the Lord's path. He's also confident because the Lord will hear him because of the Lord's character, his marvelous loving kindness. His character is that he saves those who trust in him. "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved." This belief is not just belief that he existed, but to rely upon, to trust in him. And this is what David is doing. He's trusting in the Lord. And he's saying, "Lord, keep your focus on me. Keep me as a chicken is protected by the hen, so your protection be upon me, because the enemies are out to oppress me and to destroy me." How does he describe then the enemies? "They've closed up their fat hearts. With their mouths they speak proudly." So the first characteristic of those who oppose God is that they are satisfied with themselves. They have mouths that speak proudly. They don't call upon God. Why do we need God? We can do it all ourselves. The Bible gives us examples of people who boast in themselves. Goliath boasted in himself and fell at the hand of David. David is not boasting in himself. He is boasting in the Lord. But his enemies are boasting in themselves. "Who is the God who can deliver you from my hand?" And they have surrounded us in our steps. They have set their eyes crouching down to the earth, as a lion is eager to tear his prey, and like a young lion lurking in secret places. So the enemy, who is confident of their own strength, is looking for the opportunity to attack the righteous, as Cain attacked Abel. Not because Abel had done anything against Cain, but because Abel was righteous and Cain was of the wicked one. He sought an opportunity, he found it, and he took it, and he destroyed Abel. That is the approach of the wicked. If they can destroy the righteous, they will. They are proud. They have no fear of God in their eyes. And so his prayer is, "Lord, cast him down. Deliver my life from the wicked with your sword." Notice the emphasis is on the Lord acting to judge the wicked. David is not going to do it himself. That is what the wicked do. He is looking to the Lord to vindicate him. "Deliver my life from the wicked with your sword, with your hand from men, O Lord, from men of the world who have their portion in this life, whose belly you fill with your hidden treasure." These are people who receive much from God, but they do not acknowledge God, even though they are fat from what the Lord has given them. They are men of the world. They don't see the eternal perspective. They are living for the present and for the now. And so they want to enjoy the present. And if David is king and he says, "No, you shall not indulge in these practices," then David becomes their enemy, because he is preventing them. And so they are looking for opportunities to attack. And so the righteous will seek to restrain the wickedness of the wicked by being salt in the community and light in the community. And so they are attacked for just speaking the truth. These people are satisfied with their life now. They are satisfied with children and leave the rest of their possession for their babes. They're just living for this world. But David's hope is not in this world. "As for me, I will see your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake in your presence." He's looking forward to the future. He's looking forward to the day when he will stand before his God. After death is resurrection, a resurrection body like unto his glorious body. As for me, I will seek your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake in your likeness.